So we can't see the audience number here.
No, sir. Like in YouTube, you can see there is a 23 watching now. Okay. In that way, I will keep updated to you. But if from Zoom, we can't see the audience number.
Okay.
But in YouTube, you can see that. Okay. Welcome to BioEngine webinar. Welcome everyone to BioEngine webinar series. Today it's our 34th number webinar. We appreciate all of your participation, interest in our BioEngine. Today we have our team as a team member, Jacinta, Dr. Jacinta from Canada, Dr. Neha from Australia, and Shoma. We try to address all of your questions. Please put your question in YouTube chat box only. We collect the questions from there. Related questions will be provided to the speaker. If it's not related to today's talk, please email us. Don't put the question in YouTube chat box. Those are already registered. The feedback or certification application link has been provided to your email address. Check your spam folder if it's not get it. Or if somehow it's missed, then email us. I can provide it once again. So I request Jacinta to start the webinar.
Thanks, Shivo. Good evening, everyone, or good morning from wherever you are. Welcome to the BioEngine webinar series. The webinar series is a platform from which plant scientists can present their research to the world and where future scientists can gain knowledge, perspective, and inspiration. Today is our 34th webinar of the series. We welcome all our viewers who have joined us from across the world. If you are new to BioEngine, please note that after attending today's talk, you can apply for a certificate of participation. For this, you will need to submit the feedback form that you have received in your email. The password will be provided multiple times in the YouTube chat after the presentation. When you fill out the feedback form, please mention the full name of your institute and its full address. You can collect your participation certificates after 2 days from our website. BioEngine does not send certificates through email. Please visit our website to register for upcoming webinars. You may submit articles for the BioEngine Plant Science Journal. This journal is a peer-reviewed, open access international journal. You may also send us your published posters to be displayed on our website. You can also connect with BioEngine via Facebook, YouTube, Twitter, and LinkedIn. To date, the BioEngine YouTube channel has reached over 7.8 thousand subscribers. We now have 5.1 thousand subscribers on Facebook, and our LinkedIn account has 2.3K plus connections. We thank you for all your support and appreciation. And I now request Neha to introduce our guest speaker for today's webinar. Thanks.
Thank you, Jacinta. Hello, everyone. The topic for today's webinar is Enhancing Yield in Rice Employing a Systematic Marker-Assisted Gene Pyramiding by Dr. Lakshmi Narayan R. Vemireddy. Dr. Vemireddy obtained his MSc from Genetics and Plant Breeding from SV Agricultural College, affiliated under Acharya NG Rangan Agricultural University, Angrau, Tirupati in 2000, and PhD from Center for DNA Fingerprinting and Diagnostics, that is CDFD, Hyderabad in 2008. He did his postdoc fellowship from Oklahoma State University, Stillwater, USA in 2014 under Raman Postdoc Fellowship, sponsored by the University Grants Commission, New Delhi. He has more than a decade of research experience in rice molecular genetics and breeding, as evident from his publications in reputed international journals. He was involved in the development of a capillary electrophoresis-based microsatellite DNA profiling protocol, which facilitates quick and accurate detection and quantification of adulteration in basmati rice, thereby helping expand and sustain export opportunities. From his significant work, Agricultural and Processed Food Products Export Development Authority, that is APEDA, from CDFT, a center was initiated and established at CDFT for basmati DNA analysis. And he was also involved in identification of several QTLs of promise pertaining to yield and its components from wild species and primitive cultivars of rice. He has also identified and mapped QTLs governing important quality traits and dissected a major QTL governing the grain size of basmati rice. He also identified and mapped a novel dwarfing gene that's called alternate dwarfing gene AST1 in rice. He has also identified evenly distributed hypervariable rice microsatellite markers that have the potential to be used for background selection of marker-assisted breeding in rice. Further, he disproved the age-old fact that the genetic diversity of modern cultivars is narrowing. Contrarily, he demonstrated that the molecular genetic diversity of major Indian rice cultivars over the decadal periods from 1960s to 2000 is increasing. He has also developed DNA fingerprints and QR codes for major Indian rice varieties using molecular markers and uncovered many novel alleles from key yield genes by targeted resequencing in rice. Very recently, two QTLs governing the yield under drought stress have been transferred into two popular rice varieties through marker-assisted backcross breeding. In short, his contribution to rice genetics and breeding is invaluable and most significant for the farming community. It's an honor to have him with us today. I now request Dr. Vemi Reddy to please share his screen and start his talk.
Yes, sir.
It's visible.
Am I audible to all?
Yes, sir.
So, good morning, everyone. First of all, I would like to thank BioEngine founder Dr. Majumdar for giving this opportunity. And I am very thankful to Dr. Neha Sharma for her nice introduction. So, today I would like to share my experiences with rice breeding, especially for enhancing the yield using marker-assisted gene pyramiding. So here actually three things I would like to stress. First one is the why to enhance the yield. Okay. So the second one is the what is meant by a marker. And the third one is the what is meant by the gene pyramiding. Okay. So these are the three things I would like to stress. So I am Dr. Lakshmarayana Vemi Reddy from Acharya NG Ranga Agricultural University, working as associate professor. So this is our Acharya NG Ranga Agricultural University. Headquarters is located in Guntur, Andhra Pradesh. So I am happy to share some of the interesting things. That is, released four mega varieties. Those are MTU 7029 Swarna, Cotton Dara Sannalu, and MTU 1001 Vijeta, and BPT 5204. So these four mega varieties are released from our university only. So I am happy to be a part of this university. Coming to the first question, why to enhance the yield in rice? See, rice is a staple food which is a staple food for more than 50% of the global population. But if you see the compared to the population growing exponentially, but the yields are not growing accordingly. See, if you see the statistics, still we need 116 million extra tons by 2035. That means we can observe at least 8 to 10 million tons more paddy rice each year. That reflects annual increase of 1.2 to 1.5% over the coming decades, which is equivalent to 0.6 tons per hectare during the next decade. Now, this is a very challenging task because the natural resources like fertilizers, water, and all are shrinking, and at the same time, the area also shrinking. On top of it, we need to enhance the yield level. So, keeping this in view, my research work mostly focuses on enhancing the yield using the mostly marker-assisted breeding methods. So coming to the second question, this is for students. Especially I have seen the type of audience. Many of them are undergrad students also there. So they may not be knowing the marker. So they think marker means like permanent marker is there. But marker means anything which can distinguishes two varieties or two species. Okay. So I don't want to go into the details of markers. I just want to touch upon what are different types of markers. In fact, we can use any phenotype or biochemical, like any enzymes or metabolite, even any chromosome, like any DNA molecule, anything we can use it as a markers. Okay. So in fact, you can see within a cell, we can use DNA as a marker, chromosomes as a marker, RNA also as a marker, and protein also as a marker, right? So this is the classification of DNA-based markers, which are predominantly used all over the world. So among these markers, mostly the developing countries like India, we are using mostly simple sequence repeats or microsatellite markers. So in our lab, we have shortlisted some of the microsatellite markers which gives more polymorphism, because polymorphism means that is a key to distinguish two varieties. These are called hypervariable markers. You know, in rice, there are more than 50,000 markers are available. So for a layman, like a conventional breeder, it's very confusing which markers to be taken for their studies, for their genetic diversity study or for marker-assisted breeding study or so. So here we have shortlisted most probable hypervariable SSR markers which can give more polymorphism. And these markers should be equally distributed on all 12 chromosomes of rice. So we have divided all the markers into different bins, each bin consisting of 10 markers. So the distance between the two bins is around 5 MB. So like this, we have shortlisted, and these markers are being used for many studies like diversity studies and marker-assisted breeding and all these things. So I would like to just tell how these markers will be screened. Just I'll give an overview. So if you want to study a variation between two varieties, first thing is you have to collect the leaf sample, either from leaves or pods, or not only leaf, you can, for that matter, you can take any tissue. Okay, because DNA is available throughout the organism. Okay, so we can extract the leaf samples and extract the DNA, and we can amplify the PCR. Because if you load the DNA in the agarose gel, you will see the entire genomic DNA, which is of no use. We want to see the variation in a particular area of a DNA. So if you want to see only a particular area, we have to specify it through primers, and we have to amplify through PCR. Then after PCR, we have to run, separate those alleles using the gel electrophoresis units. Then we can go for marker analysis. So this is just overview of the marker genotype. So if you have a just a small laboratory with a small setup, like a small centrifuge with one PCR, one gel electrophoresis unit, and one gel documentation system, we can do many things. That's what we are doing in our university. So using these markers, there are many breeding methods are developed: marker-assisted back cross breeding, marker-assisted pedigree selection, marker-assisted pyramiding, marker-assisted recurrence selection, and genomic selection. So I don't want to go into the details. I just want to give the list. So the third question is, what is gene pyramiding, right? So this is also using the markers. It's a process of combining multiple genes or QTLs together into a single genotype or single variety, we can say. So this is actually possible through conventional breeding also, but extremely difficult or impossible, we can say, selecting the plant at early generation. Because see, any plant or any crop at early generations, we cannot make out any differences phenotypically, right? But we can see that difference using the molecular markers. So here I will just give the advantages of this marker-assisted gene pyramiding. Usually, this marker-assisted gene pyramiding can be used for simply inherited traits, but they are difficult to, or we can say expensive to, measure phenotypically, right? So especially you see the rice amylose content. This is proved that it is a simply inherited trait, say controlled by single gene. But under the field condition, we cannot measure, because amylose content will be in the grain, because starch content will decide the amylose. So in that case, we cannot use the phenotypic expression. Okay. So other one is the traits which are traditionally regarded as a quantitative and not targeted by the gene pyramiding program. So quantitative traits like yield and yield component traits, they are governed by many genes. So those things, generally breeders will not take into the consideration while pyramiding program, because they are controlled by many genes. Conventionally, we do not know where those genes are located, right? But here, using the molecular markers, we can pyramid those genes. And another one is the genes which are similar phenotypic effects. Like two varieties show the same yield, but their yield contribution is due to different yield component traits. Those things we cannot see under the field conditions. So in that case also, we can use markers. And the final one is the linkage drag. So usually breeders, we try to incorporate some desirable characters, but the undesirable genes or traits which are tightly linked to the desirable ones, which are also come along with it. So in that case, conventional methods, we cannot separate those two characters. But using the molecular markers, we can avoid this linkage drag, and we can speed up the recurrent parent genome selection also. So these are the advantages of this marker-assisted gene pyramiding. So here, simply I will tell about the, usually in the breeding genetics, you can see, suppose two parents are there in the breeding plan. You see the one is the gene A and gene B, we want to merge into a single plant. What we will do, we will make a cross, the F1 and F2 we will use it. We will advance using the selfing procedure. But phenotypically, we do not know which plant has these two genes, right? But using the molecular markers, we can clearly pinpoint and different allele types. And here you can see in the F2, if you see the segregating population, 16 possible genotypes possible with the two alleles. So here, if you want to select the only plant with the homozygous condition for these two genes, we can select using the molecular markers. So that is the beauty of this QTL pyrimiding strategy. So there are many QTL pyrimiding strategies are there. First one is the no backcross. No backcross means, suppose there are so many yield component traits are there. They are located in different varieties. We want to combine all these favorable alleles into a single variety. Like here you can see, this is the donor for grain number. First you have to cross donor for panicle number. Then you make a cross. Then again, cross between donor for grain weight and donor for grain filling. Then you make a cross and intercross these two F1s. Then once you intercross, we will get a root genotype. Okay, this is called root genotype. Then we can go for fixation. So here we will not do any backcross. So the second one is the assemblage first. Assemblage first means, first we will assemble into a single variety by two different crosses. Then we can use recurrent parent. We want all these four characters in the background of a particular high yielding variety or a popular variety. Then you can use the backcross method. The third one is the backcross first. Here, individual variety, you make a cross with the recurrent parent. You make a F1. F1 again cross with the recurrent parent. You get BC1 F1. Again cross like this, BC2 F1 for each trait. Once we reach the trait-specific introgression lines for each trait, we can make an intercross among themselves. Then we can develop the pyramided trait-specific introgression lines. Okay. So once we get the root genotype, we can go for fixation by simply selfing by single seed descent method or using the double haploid method or homozygous gene pyramiding. So this is the different types of gene or QTL pyramiding strategies people are being used. So coming to the actual thing, how to enhance the yield in rice. So here also we can see, if you see the rice breeding over the decades, there are two breakthroughs we have already witnessed. In 1960s, the first breakthrough in the form of Green Revolution, where we have introduced the semi-dwarf varieties, and the second breakthrough in the form of hybrid technology. So we are actually eagerly waiting for the next breakthrough, or we can say the third breakthrough. Okay, because 50% of the more rice is required by 2050. Because whatever breakthroughs we are explaining here, those technologies have not reached entire the world, especially African countries. And within India, we can see northeastern states, and mostly the varieties which are developed are suitable to irrigated conditions. But in India, if you see, the area for irrigated is only 55%. Remaining 45% is under rain-fed condition. Okay, so we need a next breakthrough.
Sorry to disturb you. Sir, there is a background noise. Maybe it's from your fan. Is it rotating, or if it's possible to, you can fix in a one direction?
Just one second.
Yes, it creates lots of background noise.
Is it okay now?
Yes, sir. I think it's okay. Actually, few people are asking what to do in from the YouTube. Okay, sir. It's now better.
Okay, I'm using cooler, so I can use normal fan also.
Okay, sir. So, okay, sir. If now it's okay.
Okay, sir? Okay.
Yes, sir. Please continue.
Thank you. So, as I was telling, the first breakthrough in the form of grain revolution, second breakthrough in the form of hybrid rice technology. But during 1960s and 70s, we don't have a much advances in the molecular biology tools. But now, if you see, there are a lot of advances we can witness in the form of sequencing, in the form of development of the markers, in the form of construction of the linkage map, and to know the functions of the genes and all these things. So a lot of cutting edge tools have come. So these tools can be employed using the different strategies for enhancing the next breakthrough. Okay, so here just some of the important strategies I have given. First one is the enrichment of the gene pool, exploitation of the wild species, and designing of the plant architecture and the alternate semi-dwarf, and engineering starch biosynthesis and enhancing the photosynthesis. So in our lab, we are trying to do as many strategies as possible to enhance the yield levels, mostly using the marker-assisted breeding only. So the first one, enrichment of the rice gene pool. So we all know rice is endowed with hundreds of thousands of land races, right? So from the past 50 years, we have developed, especially in India, we have developed more than 1200 rice varieties. Okay, so the question is the rice genetic diversity increasing or decreasing over the decades? So that's what we try to answer this question. So if you see the donor varieties which have been deployed for development of the varieties in the irrigated and the rainfed ecologies, majority of the times IR8 and TN1 Jaya have been used. Okay, so here only few varieties have been used as a donor in case of irrigated. Similarly, in case of rainfed ecology, Pankaj, IR8 and Mashuri and TN1. Okay, so these are the only few varieties have been used. So everybody says whether we are really narrowing down the genetic diversity of the varieties. So we want to verify this, whether this concept is correct or not. So if you go through the literature, different people have reported different conclusions. Somebody says genetic diversity is increasing, somebody says decreasing, somebody says there is no change, like this. So with this background, we also want to test in Indian varieties how this genetic diversity is increasing. So for this, we have collected the 100 rice varieties, which includes the land races, and for the varieties which are released on decade wise, 1970s, 1980s, 1990s and 2000. Then we have used 50 hypervariable microsatellite markers. We have screened all these markers. And surprisingly, we observed the genetic diversity of Indian rice varieties are increasing over the decadal period. That indicates that is based on the changes in number of alleles, even niche genetic diversity index, even polymorphism information content also clearly says the genetic diversity of the Indian rice cultivars is increasing. Then what is the reason for whether increasing or decreasing of this genetic diversity? We observed allelic level. So what we have observed, we observed some of the new alleles are appearing over the decades, and some of the important alleles we are losing, right? So so this is the reason we observed. So that's why we have to conserve those important alleles in order to sustain our food production. So with this, we proposed one model. So first we have to select the germplasm, and we can do the phenotyping and genotyping. We can use marker trait association. Then we can identify the novel alleles and superior alleles. So whatever alleles, novel alleles and superior alleles, which governs the yield characters, those alleles can be reintroduced to the elite varieties of the present today. Okay, because some of the alleles we are losing, some of the alleles we are getting. training. So using this reintroduction, we can design our breeding programs so that we can sustain our food production. And in addition to that, we have also identified some of the important alleles for grain size characters, and similarly for yield characters, yield genes like GS3 and SW5, DEP1, GN1A. So we observed lot of superior and novel alleles in our Indian genotype. So only thing is, we are not knowing where to use, how to use these alleles for the enhancing the yield. So the second option is the discovery and stacking of yield genes. We know the wild and weedy species also having the yield enhancing genes, which are proved by many people, right from McCooch, Tanksley, to in India, Professor Siddiq and all this. So we also proved that the wild species, Voraja rufipogon and Nivara, having the yield enhancing genes. Okay. So these genes we can introgress into our Indian cultivar. So after a national professor project, which was led by Professor E.S. Siddiq, Dr. Sarla continued the material, and she developed a DRR than 40. Okay. This is a remarkable achievement of DRR from Dr. Sarla, so which enhances the yield. So this is from wild species only, Nivara, rufipogon. So second option will be exploring the alternate dwarf genes. So as I was telling, in the Green Revolution, we have introduced so many semi-dwarfing genes, SD1 genes, especially in case of the rice, in case of wheat, Norin-10 genes. So these, after introduction of these genes, the plant weight has been reduced tremendously. Okay, and with the reduce of plant weight, the harvest index of the varieties have been increased. That's almost touched the 0.5, and they are showing the fertilizer responsiveness. So these varieties, the first variety that is called IR8, which is derived from PETA and DG Vision cross. So this semi-dwarf one gene, actually the source is DG Vision. So this the IR8 has been used continuously in the breeding programs as a donor. So so many varieties have been released even from throughout India. So here we can see the same semi-dwarf one gene has been spread across the globe, the same allele. So with this background, so scientists have identified the gene which controls the SD1 gene also. They say GA20 oxidase is the main candidate gene which governs this semi-dwarf one gene. So here you can see this gene has a 3 exons. So here the 383 base pair deletion from exon 1 and exon 2 is the main reason for the non-functioning of this GA20 oxidase. Because of this deletion, this gene has shown non-functionality. So the plant is becoming dwarf because of the lack of growth. Okay. So everybody started using the same IR8 variety as a donor. So as you know, if you use single gene to develop a variety, it leads to so many disadvantages like yield stagnation, susceptible to many diseases and pests. Here you might have observed a lot of new pests and new diseases have come after Green Revolution. Okay, but there are so many people try to identify the different semi-dwarf genes. There are so many genes have been identified which are located on almost all chromosomes. But the problem is their application to the rice breeding found to be very rare, because these semi-dwarf genes, they are showing the pleiotropic effect. Means if we try to increase the yield, they are causing the inviting more diseases and pests, something like that. Okay. So with this background, we also started to identify whether we can identify any semi-dwarf gene. We collected the different dwarf accessions from bark, and we have screened with the gene-specific marker from SD1 gene. So we have identified, we want to see the dwarf accession without the 383 base pair deletion, but still a dwarf rise. So such kind of dwarf plants we have selected. There we have used for crossing with a tall variety, that is INRC10192, that is a land race. We developed the simple F2 mapping population by selfing. And we have used the QTL-seq approach. We have identified one major QTL on chromosome 1, which we have confirmed with our linkage map also. So this major QTL, which is explaining the more than, here you can see around 40% or 60% phenotypic variance, it is explained. Then we would like to see what is the gene, candidate gene behind this QTL. Then we try to narrow down this QTL region. We found 9 annotated genes were there. Using the expression analysis, we found that IWS1 is the candidate gene. Then we transferred to a tall variety using the marker-assisted breeding, whether this gene will really reduce the plant height or not. See, here you can see this is a dwarf accession which we have used as a donor, and this is a tall accession. So this is a backcross line with the ASD1 gene. So here it reduces the plant height substantially. Not only that, it enhances the yield levels also. So this kind of genes we can identify more, and we can try to incorporate into our elite cultivars. And the other one is the introgression of yield under drought stress condition. You know, there are different ecosystems are there. As I already explained, the green revolution fruits have reached only irrigated ecologies. Still, there is a substantial room to increase the yield levels in rain-fed condition. Okay. So here you can see under drought condition, yield losses, we can expect some 42. Around 80% also. So Dr. Arvind Kumar group from IRRI, they have identified many yield QTLs, means the QTLs which enhances the yield under moisture stress condition. See, they are called DTY QTLs. Okay, so these are some of the donor varieties and the QTL location, and like this many QTLs have been identified. So we try to introgress those QTLs related to yield under moisture stress condition and into the our popular cultivars like MTU 1010 and NLR 33349 through marker-resistant backcross breeding. Through the marker-resistant backcross breeding, we have introgressed, and when we evaluated, we observed substantial yield enhancement under stress condition. So here you can see the clear-cut yield enhancement over the parents in the both MTU 1010 and NLR 33349. So here you can see the yield enhancement. More than 20% yield enhancement we observed in the two QTL introgressive lines compared to the single QTL introgressive lines and the parent. So now we are continuing those material in the advanced yield trials. Different yield trials are being conducted in our farm. So the second one is not only marker-assisted backcross breeding, even we can use simple marker-assisted pedigree breeding for pyramiding of the important genes or QTLs from two diverse parents. So here we have used we developed the pyramided lines by combining yield characters, drought and heat stress tolerance characters through marker-assisted pedigree breeding. So here we have taken the IR64, which is a high yielding variety, and N22, which is drought and heat tolerant landers. So we would like to combine these two characters into a single allied variety. That is a normal breeding program, but here we have used markers in addition to the phenotypic selection. So here we can see the different pyramidal lines and their gene combinations. So here you can see these are the water use efficiency QTLs and DTY QTLs, heat tolerance QTLs and yield QTLs and their different QTL combinations. So these combinations we have tested using the markers which are specific to different targeted QTLs, and we observed substantial yield enhancement in these pyramidal lines with the all the important QTLs also. So these lines also we forwarded to the yield trials which are being conducted, just initiated last season only. And the other one is not only for improving the drought or moisture, heat stress condition, even we can change the plant architecture also using the marker assisted gene pyramiding. See, because this strategy has been employed by many people and they claim the yield enhancement is substantial. Here you can see more than 10% yield enhancement they observed. Actually, in the rice, 5% yield enhancement is more than enough to release as a variety. So the same strategy we also followed here. So here, you know, the BPT-5204 is a high yielding and good cooking quality rice. And we crossed with the 3626, which is having the high grain filling and with high grain weight also. Similarly, NLR-33892, it is a high grain number variety with blast resistance and all these things. So we would like to combine all these characters in a systematic gene pyramiding. So after development of the backcross lines, we have intercrossed these genes. Like here, we have chosen GS5, GS3, and GW5, case of the one cross, other cross, DEP1 and LP1. So these are the cloned genes which are known to govern a yield component rates. So we try to combine the all allied lines into a single variety, single line. So we observed, we developed so many pyramidal lines. So here we can see the line which is having the four genes showing the yield advantage of around 35%. So like this, we can use the markers for systematic pyramiding of all these genes. Okay. So here also we can see the at least 10% yield advantage we observed. So that is the beauty of employing these markers in the regular breeding program. So here also we can see the variation in the different panicles in the grain types of these pyramidal lines. So these pyramidal lines also under yield trials last season started. So here, what are the limitations of this marker-assisted gene pyramiding or marker-assisted breeding? Okay. So first thing is a lack of resources, skilled labor, reliable markers, and high cost. So compared to the conventional breeding, undoubtedly marker-assisted breeding requires a sophisticated laboratory required, and we need a consumables, and we need a markers which are linked to the phenotype. And in addition to that, we need a skilled labors and consumables, everything is required. Okay. And in addition to that, we need a, we have to develop a linkage map before executing the marker assisted breeding. Because unless you identify the marker which is tightly linked to the gene or QTL, it's very difficult. Because if it is loosely linked, there must be a recombination possibility. Okay, so that is the second one. And third important one is the lack of candidate genes underlying major QTL. See, if you see this interesting chart prepared by us for important characters. So the blue color indicates these are the total QTLs. And this red color indicates the cloned genes. And this green color indicates the balance. So here you can see total QTLs and the balance almost equal in all the important characters, yield component rates. That means still a lot to be done to pinpoint the candidate genes underlying this QTL. So actually, we are trying to use the in silico analysis for identifying of this candidate gene. So that is one of the lacuna in marker-assisted breeding. And the fourth one is the reliability of the QTL mapping. So many people identify the QTLs based on the one environment. Okay. Because if you use phenotypic data of one environment, the QTL may not be that much strong, and the phenotype and the marker linkage is very loose. So we need to test in a different environment in order to identify the stable or major QTLs. Okay. And the other one is our final one is the integration of molecular biology into plant breeding is often lacking. This is very much true in countries like India, because there is a clear-cut demarcation of conventional breeders and the molecular breeders. Conventional breeders say, with the conventional breeding, we can do many things. Okay, and the molecular breeders say, with the molecular breeders, we can do many things. But there is a huge gap is there between these two. Unless we fill that gap, it is very difficult to achieve the this sustained food production. So there are so many prospects are there. Marker-assisted gene breeding, it must be integrated into the existing plant breeding programs throughout the world. So that has to be done. Especially in India, very few laboratories or very few people have this kind of facilities. So if we can integrate this marker-assisted breeding into the routine breeding programs, definitely we can increase the precision by combining the favorable alleles. Okay. So the second one is using the marker-assisted pyramiding, we can enhance the genetic gain also in conjunction with traditional breeding. Because using the only traditional breeding, we almost saturated the yield levels. Okay, now this is the time to integrate this marker-assisted breeding with the conventional breeding to enhance the genetic gain so that we can enhance the yield levels and we can meet the projected demand of the 2050. So these are the different PhD students and MSc students. They are our strength and our weakness also. They are really our hands. They only identify all these things. So I'm very thankful to my PhD students, MSc students, and my collaborators are there. And within a university, Dr. Ramesh Babu, Sri Lakshmi from Agriculture Research Station, Nellore, and Dr. P.V. Ramana Rao from RARS Maruteru, and Babin Tanti from Guwahati University. So my majority of the projects are funded by internal funding like ANGRU and ICR, Extramural Research Grant, and Department of Biotechnology. I'm very grateful to the external funding agencies. So thank you very much. Thank you for your attention. I'm happy to take any questions from the audience.
Yes, thanks, sir. Actually, we are waiting for a question. We are go to the interview sections right now. And
shall I close the share?
Yes, sir. You close the sharing. Okay. So I request Soma to do your interview session. And after that, we are going to the question answer round. and those are watching, please put your question on YouTube chat box. I will collect them. Thanks. Soma.
Hello, everyone. Is my audio okay? Okay. Hello, everyone. You were watching Dr. Vemi Reddy's very enlightening and informative talk on enhancing yield in rice, employing a systematic marker-assisted gene pyramiding. We will now move on to the interview section of today's event. Hello, sir. We are very lucky to have you with us today. We will take this opportunity to know more about you. We would love to know how you built your career. Could you please share your journey as a plant scientist with our viewers?
So, actually, I think you already mentioned my BSc Agriculture and MSc Agriculture from Acharya Engineering Agriculture University only. So, my specialization in genetics and plant breeding. So, till MSc AG, I am not much interested in research and all these things. So only I joined National Professor Project in the Directorate of Rice Research as a senior research fellow with Dr. Professor E.A. Siddiq. So I think he is a renowned rice breeder. He is also called as Mr. Rice in India. So I got the opportunity to work with him. So I really loved that environment working with him. That because whatever till MSc, my journey was different. After MSc, I started isolating DNA, and I amplified the DNA, run the gel electrophoresis. No, these are all really excited to me as a youngster.
Right.
So which really attracted me to bring into this research field. So after DRR, I moved to the CDFD. I think you might be knowing the Center for DNA Fingerprinting and Diagnostics located in Hyderabad. Yeah. There that is an entirely different world because there is nobody works on plants, mostly works on animals, bacteria. So I got the opportunity to expose different science actually. That is as an agriculture, I always see the plant. Mm-hmm. But after going the CDFD, so this is a science. Then I understood. During the canteen periods of CDFD, they speak science, they sleep science, they eat science like this. There is no, other world. So in that world, I was there for 6 years. I did my PhD for 6 years. Then now I am trying to, share my experience and knowledge to my students in the form of giving the good PhD or MSc research work. So that is my journey.
Okay, that was wonderful to hear from you, sir. What motivates you to work for the betterment of agriculture?
See, India is for India, agriculture is a backbone, right?
Yes.
Still around 60% population depends on only agriculture.
Yes.
So we witness so many problems in agriculture. As an agriculture graduate student, we have to stay in a village in our final year of BSc Agriculture. That is called RAVE, Rural Agricultural Work Experience Program. We have to stay in a village for 6 months. For the entire semester.
That's great.
During that time, I observed many problems faced by the farmers. Environment plays a major role, and they won't get sufficient yield. Sometimes major diseases and pests, and there is no proper market. There is no proper benefit. So all these things really motivate me to continue this field. So that's why I determined to do something beneficial to the farmers, especially to enhance the yield levels. Okay. So that's my thing.
According to you, which sectors of plant science research will prosper in the near future?
See, plant science research, there is a lot of gap is there compared to humans and bacteria. You see the type of publications and the kind of publications. We can see majority of the publications are humans, or we can see in the bacteria, and or we can see in the model plants, right?
Right.
So very very few papers we can find in a Nature or Science related to a plant, or we can say crops.
Right.
So okay. So the first thing what I observed was we need to integrate this genomics, transcriptomics, proteomics, and all these things. We need to develop a systems biology to understand the functions of genes.
Mm-hmm.
So for even till today, even 90% of the breeders, they select the plant based on the phenotype. They do not know what is the gene, why it functions, why how it interacts. All these things they do not know. So now we have a technology using the systems biology. We can try to understand the what is the mechanism underlying for each character. So that is the one thing. So another thing is we can use artificial intelligence and high throughput phenotyping techniques. These things we can integrate into their routine breeding programs. So these things needs to be integrated.
Right. Okay. Do you think we should consider abiotic stress more seriously to ensure global food security during the times of climate change and global warming?
Yeah, definitely. You know, global warming, day by day, temperatures are increasing. You know, 0.5 degrees centigrade is increasing per decade.
Mm.
No, especially the heat is increasing a lot.
Yes.
Okay, heat. So we have to breed varieties for heat tolerance. And salinity also increasing a lot. And of course, moisture. So these are the three things we have to look for while developing a variety.
Along with yield improvement, do you think that proper storage of this yield is also important? And which modern tools and techniques could help us achieve this?
So storage also very important. Because especially in rice, huge amount of rice has been stored under the godown.
Mm.
So we need to develop some kind of policies so that this stored products can be properly released to the market, so that farmers will get the sufficient benefit. So we need to work in a policy makers has to work in on it.
Right. Do you think biofortified crops are the future of nutrition security?
So this is a very tricky question. You know, biofortification is, of course, it should be done as long as in the germplasm, we have a such kind of variation. Like if you see the current day cultivars, they are not much nutritious, in my opinion.
Okay.
So in the nature, in the germplasm, it is available. Definitely, we can bring it to the elite cultivars. Okay. But that doesn't mean you bring all the characters into a rice, like golden rice, which enhances the vitamin A content.
Mm-hmm.
Right? So those things we can use the biodiversity. If you see the diversity in a rice, there are hundreds of thousands of land races are being unused.
Right.
Right. Mm-hmm. Even if farmers also maintaining some of the local land races. Mm-hmm. We do not know their nutrition value.
Yes.
They say this is antioxidants and it gives more vitamins and something like that.
Mm-hmm.
And diabetic rice also people are saying. So we can explore in that direction also, in addition to improving the local varieties. So that.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Sir, kindly give our viewers some tips to improve manuscripts.
Usually how I write manuscript. So first we have to read the whatever literature available, right? You read it and don't see them. Okay. You just analyze in your mind You write in your own words.
Hmm.
Okay. So your analysis part should be written in your own words. Okay. Don't try to copy. So that is my suggestion. So, and maybe if you are English medium, it's easy to for you. For others, maybe still they can improve. But there are so many webinars nowadays. I can see. They can see those webinars even in YouTube also. You can see how to improve the manuscript and all these things. So,
okay. All right. What would your words of advice be to the students and scholars who are new to the field of plant science research?
See, I really invite many students to the plant research because a lot of gaps are there and huge challenges are there. Okay. Mm-hmm. So one thing is we have to love our work. That is my philosophy. And whatever work you are doing, you do it joyfully. Don't take it seriously. With the available facilities, with the available resources, we can create miracles. That's what my opinion.
Absolutely. Thank you, sir. It was wonderful to hear about your views. Shuvo has collected some questions from our viewers. Over to you, Shuvo.
Hi, sir.
Hi.
We discuss few things because I'm collecting those questions and you can see the questions because these are, I'm sure they are from the students. So if you wanted to reply them, you can reply or we can little bit.
So I could see the question, how many traits can be incorporated in one variety as a gene pyramiding?
Yes.
So if you see the in our experiences, we incorporated 6 genes. Okay. And the literature says even 8 genes also you can incorporate. Okay. So maybe that depends on the case by case. And the second one, how do we combine genes in a single species, either in the field or in a lab? If it is a marker-assisted breeding, it will be done in a field only, right? So field only, we have to make a cross. We have to select the plants. But selecting the plant, we have to depend on the lab through markers. So those things we have to run in a gel electrophoresis, right? If you want to do only in the lab, maybe transgenics also we can do it, like gene stacking, like different transgenes we can combine into a single variety. So like this, we can do it, either marker-assisted breeding or transgenics. So marker-assisted selection can be used for enhancing the yield under drought condition. That's what I have explained in my slides. We have incorporated QTLs related to water use efficiency, heat tolerance, and drought tolerance, right? So adverse effects means we have to see. That's why, you know, marker-assisted breeding, we cannot rely on markers 100%. We have to do phenotypic selection also simultaneously. We have to see the plant type, whether really farmers like this kind of plant type or something like that, okay? So we have to combine both.
Yes, sir. And sir, I request you, if possible, can you elaborate a little bit about the marker assistant selections and transgenic, because many people are confused with the marker assisted breeding with the transgenic and their questions are appeared to be in a transgenic field. So can you
see, usually in a marker assisted breeding we take single plant will not have all the desirable genes, right? So the desirable genes might be in a different variety. We have to combine all these things into a single variety. So in that case, what we do in the marker-assisted selection, first we make a cross between first with second, then second third with fourth, fifth and sixth, like I have shown in the picture. So again we have to intermake crosses. Crossing means hybridization, means in the one plant we have to remove the anthers, and the other plant we have to dust the pollen on the other plant. This is called hybridization. So we have to do that crossing work in case of the mark resisted breeding. So after generating this mark the population, we have to isolate the DNA from the each plant. We have to see the each variety has how many markers combination. So in my table I have shown in a color picture, this pyramided line has this many QTLs, this pyramided line has this many QTLs. Like this we have to see in the molecular level. The same thing you test in field level yield by combining these three traits or three genes, whether really showing the heat tolerance or not, are really showing the higher yield under heat tolerance or not. These things we can see using the marker. But in case of the transgenics, there no need to do any crosses. We have to bring the genes from different either plant or any bacteria or any organism. We can make a construct or a single construct or a multiple construct. There are different things are there. Or first you can make a one construct, you can transfer to a one variety. After developing out your transgenic, then you make transfer one more construct. Like this we can make it. So here no need to do any crossing work, hybridization. Mostly we have to rely on lab level. Okay, so this is a clear cut difference.
Yes sir, thank you for your clarification. And sir, from my end, I wanted to know you that generally we do the yield analysis in that way, that we collect the plant and form a plant or a few plants, like 3 or 10 plants, and we analyze that how much yield we got. But sir, what is your experience? Because I don't have such experience. I'm working on rice in a transgenic way, and we just collect in data in form that way, that whether the yield and what is the field seed in or the panicle number or the just agronomical data, and what will is it reflect in the field situation if there is a 10% increment in their yield in a pod? Is it going to be 10% or how many variable is going to be actual when it's cultivated in a hectares or in a large population?
Yes, that's whatever yield advantage I have explained, 10% or 20%, that is under field condition only.
Okay.
So under the field condition, we have to grow the control and the pyramided lines. We have to impose the stress. Then after imposing of the stress, we have to calculate the yield.
Okay.
Which line gives the more yield?
Mm-hmm.
So we have to compare with the control, like parent.
Okay. But is one-to-one plant variation between plant to plant, or is a field plot to plot?
See, these mostly yield trials we will conduct after reaching the homozygosity.
Yes.
Homozygosity in the sense, they will not segregate at all.
Yes.
So when we collected the suppose 1,000 seeds we have collected from a single plant, all 1,000 must be same. There will not be any change. That is called homozygosity. Okay, so these 1,000 plants we will grow in a small plot. So we will take the plot yield.
Okay.
This plot yield will compare with the control. Like this.
And in during the seed variety release, there are multiple location trial, and these are another things. But yes, I can understand in that way. And sir, another as you say that that is the one of reason that we build the plant our bioengine platform. That plants are very few people are working on plants, and very less number of paper and less number of availability of everything. But I appreciate your work that, as you mentioned, very many people are told that they don't getting the fund or they don't have a sophisticated laboratory to doing the research. But you shows that very small equipment you need to implement up to 10 or 20% of yield. So do you think, sir, that it's about the it's all about the perception on your motivation or dedication to the works? So if you have this thing, it will increase the it fortify our bio our plant science field, or you need a sophisticated laboratory is mandatory to doing the research?
So as I told, we require a minimum laboratory, like a small centrifuge, one PCR, one gel electrophoresis, one gel documentation. I think in our lab, I didn't keep my, our lab photo. So in our lab, only these things are there.
Okay.
And we have a very minimal budget sponsored by either ICR or DBT or our university fund. Our strength is our students. We have a MSc, AG and PhD students. So with the available students, with the available resources, we can do this much, no problem. Because we have plenty of field facilities, no problem. And reasonably labor facilities also we have. So I think with the minimum facilities, definitely we can do at least this much. We don't need a sophisticated laboratories and huge budget and all these things.
And somebody can collaborate for that. If there is a
definitely
they can isolate the
collaboration only. Yes. Whatever we are doing.
Okay. So you can start plant breeding in that way, and you can collaborate to explore the or identify the gene specific, if it is allele gene, and compare the genome. It's another part. So it's a very good approach, as you
see, whatever that I have shown here in the slides for 1 hour. This is just like a tip of the iceberg in my test.
Yes.
There are different areas our students are working.
Yes.
Like genome-wide association mapping, people are working. And even NGS technology also people are working. Even we developed the DNA fingerprints. We developed the QR codes. And of course, everything I cannot cover in a 1 hour. So I just focused on marker-assisted breeding.
So which is basic and very backbone of this type of research.
Yes.
So yes, it has been appreciated. Many people are like your presentations.
Thank you
and slide design specifically. And I can understand that lots of students are participating. Today is from many people are from Philippines, as I can say. So it's a nice pleasure, sir. You accept our invitations. You present your work, and I'm sure many people and many students are showing their interest, and they can solve many challenges. And as a platform, we can go together, and we can grow together in such a way that we can communicate in future. We can use our knowledge. We can share our research to each other. Thanks, sir, for
you, Dr. Majumdar, and Dr. Soma, for giving this opportunity to share my experiences with many of the youngsters throughout the world. So it's really indeed a pleasure to interact with you all.
Thank you, sir.
It was our pleasure. Thank you so much.
And maybe in future, we will meet again.
We hope we'll meet again in
more
the future.
Definitely.
Your plant science research. Definitely. Thanks, sir.
Thank you.
Namaste. Thanks all the viewers, those are watching our live sessions. Now it's going to be aimed, and we are giving the certificate within 2-3 days. It can be downloaded from our website, that is bioengine.com. We are not giving certificate by email or personally sent to the each and everybody. You need to be downloaded from our website. It will be available very soon. And when it's available, I will email you that it can be downloaded from our website. Don't need to email us that where is your certificate. And those are missed the link due to somehow don't worry, you can email us with today's password. I can send you the link once again. We have planned many webinars, we just organized in such a way, and we updated this webinar in our website too. So for future webinars, you need to be registered to getting the certificates. Thanks for everyone to join us. It's a nice pleasure, nice interactions, and I hopefully you are enjoy the plants and plant science research. Thanks, everyone. I'm going to end this meeting right now. Thanks, sir. Thanks.
Thank you.
Thanks, Soma. And thanks, other team members.
Thank you all.